Okay, students, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today the poem that we are going to discuss is Hawk's Monologue by the modern British poet Ted Hughes. Ted Hughes died in 1998. He is the poet, he has been the poet laureate also. He's the post-war poet. When I say post-war, it means the poets or the writers writing after the two world wars. And all these writers share some qualities. Their work usually deals with the problems faced by the post-war generations. Jung ke baad, logon ne kya problems face ki. Isse related hain ye sari jo post-war literature kehlata hai. So Ted Hughes ki is poem mein bhi aap dekhenge ke it's about the Second World War and the, not directly. Ye yaad rakhein, this poem is an indirect criticism on the cruel mindset, zulm ka jo mindset tha jiski wajah se the war, there have been wars in the world. Second World War, if we focus on Second World War, on one level the poem holds true for all the wars on the other level, on the deeper level. The poet says, Hawk's Monologue, it's briefly a poem about a bird who is sitting on the top of the tree in a wood, and all his conversation. Hawk means bird, a predatory bird. Monologue means, mono means one, log means speech, one person speaking. And here it's the hawk. And when you look at the speech, look at his words, more or less this kind of speech can be delivered by a human being. So hawk in a way has been personified, a bird has been given human qualities, and therefore the poem is an indirect criticism, indirect satire on the politicians, on the warmongers who are people who want to create wars, and it's a social satire also. The poem is also social satire on all these purposes, all these messages have been achieved by the poet through employing the character of a hawk. This hawk is sitting in the in a wood on the top of the tree, and the first word is top. This top word in a way highlights the superiority mindset. There are people who consider themselves the superior most people, the superior most nations. We have discussed the concept of the first world and the third world countries. First world are the powerful nations who are the richest nations of the world, America, Europe, these nations. And if you come down to the individual level, agar aap national, international level se, national or phir individual level pe aaye, to there are people who consider themselves superior. And there are ways through which they assert their superiority. Coming back to the poem at hand, the poet is saying that the bird is sitting on the top of the trees, and his whole speech is about his superiority, about his power, about his ability to control people. How does he control people? Not through helping them, not through educating them, not through discussion, dialogues, conversation, or even counseling. He is controlling them through intimidation. Intimidation means threaten. He threatens them through threats of physical harm, threats of death, destruction, bloodshed, violence. You will notice the imagery of violence in this poem, imagery of death and bloodshed in this poem. All his speech is replete means full of the imagery of death and destruction and bloodshed. He says at certain points, he says that my manners are tearing off heads, the allotment of death. You will notice alliteration in these lines, how the alliteration highlights the brutality of the bird, the predatory bird, hawk. Predatory means he predates on other creatures, on other birds to feed himself. And the whole speech goes on like this, ki how the whole universe has been created to serve his purposes. He is the center of the creation. He says, now I hold creation in my foot. इमेजिन ही कंसिडर्स दैट ही इज़ द सेंटर ऑफ क्रिएशन एंड द होल यूनिवर्स हैज़ बीन क्रिएटेड जस्ट टू सपोर्ट हिम, जस्ट टू हेल्प हिम, जस्ट टू प्रमोट हिज कॉज, एंड हिज कॉज इज़ द कॉज ऑफ डेथ एंड डिस्ट्रक्शन. हिज कॉज इज़ द कॉज ऑफ बुलिंग, कंट्रोल, सुपीरियोरिटी. So on the international and national level, this is a political satire, how nations bully their people, how nations or on the international level, how the powerful countries throw bombs in on the weak countries like Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, and on the more individual level, you see how the people who are full of superiority complex. And usually girls, you will notice that superiority is actually rooted in inferiority. People who are poor, who lack in character, people who have poor values, who are too materialistic, who don't want to cultivate the sense of right and wrong, they rely on personal sense of superiority, which is called megalomania. Megalomania ka word bhi maine, I have written it on the whiteboard. The picture I have shared with you. Megalomania is this sense of personal grandeur, that I am grand, I am great. And you must have observed these attitudes on the international level, on the national level, then on the social level, political levels ke alawa, social level, phir moral level pe around us, there are people who try to dominate, who try to control others, who are full of this sense of superiority. And this control and domination usually is done in two ways. In this example, it is done overtly. Overt means in an open manner. He is bullying the world around him, the whole universe in fact. He is bullying the whole universe for his personal benefits. And there are people who are coverts. Coverts means hidden. There are people who are full of this, their own sense of superiority, and you cannot notice them until you observe closely how they would be engaging in show off, how they would engage in competition, and all this show off and competition is engaged with in order to make the other person realize how they are superior and other people are inferior. This competition show-off is done for the sole purpose of asserting their fake, false, empty grandiosity. Grandiosity means superiority, power, control, and other people's helplessness or inferiority or their lesser status. So this is the brief summary of the poem. Now we'll go by the text. The Hawk's Monologue by Ted Hughes. And Hawk says, these are the words by the Hawk. This is the speech delivered by the Hawk, and you will notice the obnoxiousness of his speech. It's obnoxious. Obnoxious means disgusting. He says, "I sit in the top of the wood, my eyes closed, in action, no falsifying dream, between my hooked head and hooked feet, or in sleep rehearse perfect kills and eat." So in the first stanza, the Hawk says that he is sitting on the top of the trees, the topmost tree, and he's sitting on that top and his eyes are closed. And with those closed eyes, he is dreaming. He's in action means he's doing nothing except dreaming. And all those falsifying dreams, those dreams are about his rehearsals, that even in his dreams he is rehearsing, practicing how to kill perfectly, how to eat people up. And this hooked head and hooked feet, which is the opposite of straight. So this is the hooked thinking, the hooked mindset, the evil mindset, the vicious mindset, this which is not straightforward, which is not transparent, which is not kind, polite, compassionate, empathetic. He is just full of himself. And this physical, the hawk has this hooked, curved head and curved feet. So this physical feature also shows द विशसनेस द ईवल ऑफ हिज थॉट्स विच आर अबाउट द किल्स हाउ टू किल परफेक्टली एंड हाउ टू ईट. नेक्स्ट ही सेज द कन्वीनियंस ऑफ द हाई ट्रीज द एयर्स बॉयंसी एंड द सन्स रेज आर एन एडवांटेज टू मी. सो आई मी दैट इज़ द सेंटर ऑफ egoistic discussion. The discussion of egoistic people always centers on I. You would notice that there are people whose every sentence would start with I, will be about I, and will be centering on I. What I like, what I need, what I prefer. This is how the hawk is also telling how he feels, how he considers that the convenience of the high trees, he finds high trees convenient to sit, air's buoyancy, the power, the energy in the air, the sun's rays, the light, the direction that the sun gives, everything is to support the cause of the hawk, to support the great creature that hawk is. And the great word is used ironically. I have used it ironically. So the poem continues, and the earth's face upward for my inspection. He says that the earth's face is there for him to inspect, to see where he can kill and plunder. My feet are locked upon the rough bark. Locked means he is a rigid creature. He keeps things under his control. Locked means control, and he does not allow change. And soon you will see towards the end of the poem, he reiterates his claim that he keeps things as they are and he would not allow things to change. You know why? Because he is powerful in the moment and he does not want to lose this power. So here you see the implications of the political implications. Status quo ka word aap aksar sunte honge speeches mein, ke how some political parties want to, other parties of the status quo. Status quo means maintaining the current power politics, so that because they benefit from that power, so they don't want to change the situation, so the power does not go away, so they have to just continue with the. My feet are locked upon the rough bark. Rough bark is the branch of the tree. It took the whole of creation to produce my foot, my each feather. Now I hold creation in my foot. Look at the arrogance, the ego, the pomposity of his tone, and the mood of domination, control, intimidation that it creates. Now I hold creation in my foot, or fly up and revolve it all slowly. You can notice that the image of globe, universe in the form of a globe has been evoked as he is revolving the ball, the globe, the universe, the earth, for the inspection of the hawk. And he says, I kill where I please. So he revolves the ball, the globe that is called earth, and he revolves the ball in order to see where he can kill, where I please, because it's all mine. So he claims that everything belongs to him, and I kill where I please because it's all mine. There is no sophistry in my body. My manners are tearing off heads. There is no sophistry in my body means that he has made up his mind with clarity that his manners are tearing off heads, that he is there to kill. He is a killing machine, the allotment of death, that he is bent upon, he is giving death, allotting death. He is the harbinger of bloodshed and destruction. For the one path of my flight is direct through the bones of the living. No arguments assert my right. So he just tears the bodies apart and he breaks the bones of the living. And no arguments assert my right means that he does not accept any rational argument, any logic, that all that he is saying is wrong. बिकॉज इट इज़ ऑल बेस्ड ऑन द माइंड सेट ऑफ एरोगेंस एंड पम्पोसिटी कंट्रोल एंड वायलेंस. ही सेज दैट एवरीथिंग इज जस्टिफाइड बिकॉज ही डज नॉट एंटरटेन एनी आर्ग्यूमेंट्स, ही डज नॉट एक्सेप्ट एनी रैशनल बिहेवियर. द सन इज बिहाइंड मी, नथिंग हैज चेंज सिंस आई बिगैन. सो द सन इज बिहाइंड मी, सन इज यू नो फर्स्ट मीनिंग, लिटरल मीनिंग इज द सन, द नेचुरल फिनोमिनन. And the figurative meaning could be sun is the source of power, sun is the source of light, sun in fact is the source of all heat and life on earth. And he says, the hawk says that the sun is behind me. Nothing has changed since I began. And he says my eye has permitted no change. He says things haven't changed because he does not allow anything to change. And I told you earlier that people who support the lies, people who support the half-truths, people who support the untruths, people who support the politics of domination, control, intimidation, violence, bullying, those are the people who are benefiting from these things. They support violence, they support control, they support intimidation or bullying or harassment, psychological harassment or physical harassment, because they benefit from these things. They through these violent tactics, they assert their control. Therefore they do not permit means allow, therefore they do not allow any change. He says in the last line, the closing verse says, I am going to keep things like this. And in this line you see the irony is there, because change is the constant in the world, or change is the constant principle of life. Everything is changeable, everything is bound to change. So it's a kind of a, what would you call it, irrationality or lack of understanding, or you may call it foolishness or ignorance or just plain blind self-delusion, that he will keep the things like this when he is free and allowed to kill anyone he chooses to kill, and nobody will challenge his authority, nobody can challenge his authority. These are all lies, and you know that everything that is built on lies is destructive for mankind, it's destructive for the human race. So what makes life useful, what makes life meaningful is setting the goal of trying to be truthful. And here you should be reminded of all the previous poems we have studied, from New Year resolutions to woman work to All the World is a Stage by Shakespeare to Keats' poem When I Have Fears. All these poems, all the poets, all the writers support the truth, the whole truth, not the half truth. And the whole truth is that life is both full of joy and sorrow, as well as there are the achievements as well as the losses, the gains as well as the problems that one has to face. So accepting both sides of the picture, the goodness as well as the viciousness, accepting both sides of the picture, allowing ourselves to look at both sides of the picture, strengthens our soul, strengthens and builds our character. And since this bird, apparently the speaker in this poem is a bird, and the speaker is not willing to accept the truth, he is at the moment he is all powerful and he wants to just live and perpetuate just this moment. That ensures that he is all powerful and his authority, his sovereignty remains unquestioned. And this is just the half truth. The complete truth is, the whole truth is, that all the dictators such as Ozymandias in the poem you have studied in first year, their arrogance, their pride, their pomposity has to come to an end. नो एरोगेंट पॉम्पस पर्सन कंट्रोलिंग पर्सन कैन लिव फॉर एवर कैन बी पावरफुल फॉर एवर. सो यू हैव नोटिस दैट द पोएम हैज़ एम्प्लॉयड हाइपरबली. द राइटर हैज़ एम्प्लॉयड हाइपरबली. द एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ हाइपरबली और एग्जैजरेशन आर नाउ आई होल्ड क्रिएशन इन माई फुट, द एयर्स बॉयंसी एंड द सन्स रे आर एन एडवांटेज टू मी, माई मैनर्स आर टेयरिंग ऑफ हेड्स द अलॉटमेंट ऑफ डेथ, द सन इज बिहाइंड मी, आई एम गोइंग टू कीप थिंग्स लाइक दिस. ऑल दीज आर द एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ एग्जैजरेशन हाइपरबली. इट्स लाइक इफ यू लुक एट फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस एंड इफ यू इवेल्युएट द स्पीच यू विल नोटिस दैट इट्स more like the speech of some mad person talking, and this madness some people are able to hide, which we say are the covert bullies, the hidden bullies. And in this example, this hawk represents all those people who are unable to hide this madness of being power drunk, this madness of control and superiority. They are unable to hide it, control it, so that it shows, their rigidity shows, their cruelty shows. Hawk, at one point I would like to mention, also represents the slave mindset. You know, what is a slave mindset? Slave mindset means that one chooses to bow before the powerful. Why? Because it benefits. He wants to get benefits out of the powerful people, so he bows before the powerful, and that very person persecutes the weak. That is the slave mindset. That is also the definition of a cruel mindset. All the slave people with slave mindsets are cruel people because they have double standards. They have moral values just for words. They may be full of moral values, moral maxims, moral wisdom. That is just verbal. They just pay the lip service to the moral values or through deceptive appearances. But in fact, at heart, they support the power. They support the lies. And therefore, he says that he is going to keep things like this. This is another lie. The poem begins with a lie. I sit in the top of the wood. And the poem ends on another lie. I am going to keep things like this. And we all, the readers all know that this is impossible. Things are bound to change. And all dictators, all the cruel people have a fall. They have to be accountable for their cruelty. This is another word for cruelty is tyranny. The tyrant mindset. Who is a tyrant? A person with a tyrant mindset can also be called a person with a slave mindset, because tyrants and slave people with slave mindset are the same people. They are power hungry, and for the sake of that power they would engage in all types of deceptive appearances, half-truths, megalomania. Megalomania means stories that they tell about personal grandeur. They would be blowing their own trumpets. You see, you must have noticed, and you should observe. We should observe people around us, and we should observe first and foremost this sign within us, that we should not be pompous about ourselves. We should know our value. We should respect ourselves, but we should not be grandiose about our worth. You must have observed people who just talk about how great they are, how popular they are, how powerful they are, how religious they are. So people who are telling about their own grandeur and about their own greatness are usually fake people. And this is how the poem ends. There are some questions that you have to discuss. Discuss the images used by the poet to highlight the grandeur and impact of the hawk's physical strength and domination over other creatures. Phir ek question hai, do the hawk's assertions of all powerfulness impress you? If not, why? And then there is another question, ke discuss the poem as a political and social satire. ओके सो दीज आर फ्यू क्वेश्चंस. हॉक इज नॉट ऑफ द माइंड दैट ही हैज़ टू शेयर द एयर्स बॉयंसी एंड सन्स रे विद द अदर पीपल. ही इज नॉट इन द माइंड सेट ऑफ कोलैबोरेशन एंड कोऑपरेशन विद अदर क्रीचर्स. ही इज़ इन द माइंड सेट ऑफ डोमिनेंस कंट्रोल एंड कॉम्पिटिशन एंड इन कॉम्पिटिशन ही बिलीव्स दैट इन मे बी इन द सर्वाइवल ऑफ द फिटेस्ट. फिटेस्ट मीन्स द माइटीएस्ट द मोस्ट पावरफुल. ही कंसिडर्स हिमसेल्फ द मोस्ट पावरफुल एंड देयरफॉर ही बिलीव्स दैट ही डजंट नीड टू शेयर द नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज विद एनीवन. एवरीथिंग इज इन अंडर हिज कंट्रोल, नॉट जस्ट द यूनिवर्स, द अर्थ, द प्लैनेट अर्थ, एज वेल एज द ऑल द क्रीचर्स इन दिस अर्थ आर हिज स्लेव्स, आर देयर to serve his purposes, to fulfill his benefits. The poem tells us to differentiate between ego and self-respect. Ego is built on lies. The lies that you see Hawk is speaking throughout the poem about his perfection, about his power, about his ability to control the world, to control the other people, about his sense of superiority. Whereas self-respect is rooted in truths, in the whole truths. Truths that acknowledge that that goodness and viciousness, good and evil, day and light, day and night, rise and fall, good and bad are all inseparable things. And they are willing to work on the on their own darkness. Hawk is not willing to hold himself accountable. The sign of a good person is who hold themselves accountable and who are willingly, who offer themselves willingly for accountability and who are interested in the process of accountability, because it is for the welfare of the of a healthy society. In the creation of a healthy society, accountability is a prerequisite, an important thing. And people who do not accept accountability, who are aggressive when whenever there is an you see, he in the Hawk, he says, no arguments assert my right, that no one can hold him accountable for all this bloodshed and death and deceptive appearances of power and control. He does not control everything. For the moment he may think, but that's a lie, that's not the whole truth.